Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, the interim director of the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, and it's my pleasure to join with Michelle Wooker, who is the head of the WPI, to welcome you to a program that we're doing in partnership, our two institutions, a panel discussion on making the emergent city. As more than half the world's population now lives in urban areas, a number expected to grow to 6.3 billion by 2050, the future of cities is a topic to which Roosevelt House and the WPI will devote to a considerable attention. Earlier this academic year, Bruce Katz of Brookings came here to discuss his new book, The Metropolitan Revolution, in which he argues for a new Hanseatic League of international cities which would learn from one another. Tonight's program will deepen our exploration of the future of cities worldwide. I'm very glad Roosevelt House and the World Policy Institute are making common cause on this program. When I was president of the new school, then WPI Director Arch Gillies and I merged the WPI into the new school, and we were proud to have it and the World Policy Journal as part of our university. Its longtime editors, James Chase and Carl Meyer, and WPI leaders like Charles Swenninger and fellow Walter Russell Mead, added to the university's intellectual vitality. Alas, after my time, the new school made the mistake of encouraging the WPI to become independent again, but thanks to John Watt and others on the advisory board that became the real board once again, it has prospered as an independent institution. Tonight's program, we think, will stimulate complex and creative thinking around the contradictory fate of the 21st century city, the exploding megacities of a global south, and the shrinking rust belt cities of a global north. Tonight's conversation will help us understand the challenges facing cities and some of the lessons that New York and other U.S. cities might learn from emerging megacities around the globe. We gather in the homes of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt and Franklin's mother, Sarah. You're Sarah here, you're Eleanor and Franklin there. And I think FDR would be pleased, and there they are looking down on us, with our topic tonight. Making the emergent city, we'll look at what the informal sector, citizens themselves, can do to build cities that are decent places to live and work, are resilient, and are avenues of opportunity for people of all backgrounds to improve their lives. FDR understood that government could not fix every problem, that local initiative was important. Hear his words speaking to his neighbors in Poughkeepsie in 1933. Franklin Roosevelt's words. More men and more women are taking an individual, a personal interest in all the problems, the social relations and economic and political problems, than ever before in the history of the nation. And I hope that that interest will be extended to the problem of local government as well. And Franklin Roosevelt understood that business as usual would not do. Like the World Policy Institute, he challenged us to see our problems in all their complexity and be bold in thinking about future solutions. Giving a commencement address at Oglethorpe University, he said, FDR again, "The country needs, and unless I mistake its temper, the country demands bold, persistent experimentation. We need enthusiasm, imagination, and the ability to face facts, even unpleasant ones, bravely. We need to correct, by drastic means if necessary, the faults in our economic system from which we now suffer. We need the courage of the young. Yours is not the task of making your way in the world, but the task of remaking the world which you will find before you." Moving now as it was then. And so that leads to our topic tonight, how citizens from Detroit to Lagos to Kathmandu can remake their cities. To introduce and moderate our panel tonight, I will shortly call on Kavita Rajagopalan, Senior Fellow at the World Policy Institute and co-leader of the Institute's Emergent Cities Program. The program develops and pilots new ways to activate resilient urban spaces in the economically troubled and shrinking cities of the West, using lessons from cities in the developing world characterized by high rates of migration and informality, that is to say, emergent cities. Kavita is author of Muslims of Metropolis, the stories of three immigrant families in the West, a narrative nonfiction examination of migration, integration, and identity formation in three Muslim immigrant families. Her projects include research and advocacy on the causes and consequences of undocumented migration, urban informality, and minority access to mainstream financial systems. She writes widely on global migration and diversity and has taught related courses at NYU's Center for Global Affairs. After our panel talks among themselves for 40 minutes or so, we'll open up for your questions and we'll be over by, say, 7:15, 7:20 at the latest. Kavita.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Fanton, for such a warm introduction and thought-provoking as well. I want to welcome all of you here, and a special thanks as well to Michelle Wooker and my colleagues at the World Policy Institute, who are bringing together interesting people to come up with complex solutions every day to global problems. And we are very, very excited to be exercising our partnership with the Roosevelt House, which has always been a thought leader here in the city. And of course, very excited to be in this home where we saw some of our country's greatest leaders bring thought into practice in ways that continue to shape the way that we interact with each other. I'd like to very briefly introduce our panelists today. We are very, very pleased and excited to bring to you people who are working, who are thought leaders and experts in very different aspects of urban life today. And I think the conversations that we've already had in the run-up to this event have been so stimulating that I hope that we can captivate you as much as we've captivated each other, I think I can say, in the course of this conversation. I also wanted to let you know that this entire conversation is going to be live-streamed, and we are also going to be inviting conversation and questions from our followers on Twitter as well. So we are happy to be a part of a broader conversation as well. First, I'd like to introduce Jill Simone Gross, who is a faculty associate here at the Roosevelt House. She is an associate professor of political science in the Department of Urban Affairs and Planning at Hunter College, and has taught throughout the city at many reputed institutions, including Barnard College, Columbia University, NYU, Queens College, and Brooklyn College. So an all-borough scholar here. She serves on the governing board of Urban Affairs Association, and she chairs the Committee on International Urban Linkages, an issue I think we should have time to discuss here as well. And she teaches and conducts research in comparative urban politics and development in Western European and Northern American cities, with an emphasis on the big issues of our day: equity, governance, and inclusion. She has a PhD in political science from CUNY, from the Graduate Center, and an MSc in British government from the LSE, London School. And in 2012, she was awarded a Fulbright Schumann Award to research the governance of migrant political integration in European cities. And of course, integration means lots of things. We'll discuss what that means here. She has co-authored Governing Cities in a Global Era and is currently completing her next book project on the topic of Ireland, migrants, and the fiscal crisis. We are also joined today by Mark Norman, who is the director of Upstate Center for Design, Research, and Real Estate. Mark is a trained urban planner and has worked in the fields of community development and finance for over 15 years. He holds degrees in political economics from University of California at Berkeley, as well as in urban planning from UCLA, and has developed and financed over 2,000 units, totaling more than $400 million in total development costs. So he has lived what he teaches. He has worked for profit and nonprofit organizations and is committed to community development and affordable housing. He's taught courses on real estate and housing policy in the School of Architecture and implements initiatives at Upstate in collaboration with city, state, and university partners. We are also joined today by Emeka Okafor, who is a self-described venture catalyst and the co-founder and curator of Maker Faire Africa. He was the director for TED Global in 2007. Maker Faire, we have just learned today, is going to be holding its next convention of makers in South Africa in August of this year. It has previously been held in Lagos, and in Ghana, and in Cairo. Very exciting range of different people who are making things. He's currently an advisor to TED Fellows, which he helped found, and his interests include sustainable technologies in the developing world and paradigm-breaking technologies. He's going to tell us what that means. His blog, Timbuktu Chronicle, seeks to spur dialogue in areas of entrepreneurship, technology, and the scientific method as it impacts Africa. I want to encourage all of you to welcome our panelists. So to kick off our conversation, we wanted to drop the bomb on all of you, the word informality. It's been discussed and dissected in pretty much every discipline in the social sciences and economics, and really it can mean a number of different things. We ask the question in our work variously, what is informality? What does it look like? Who does it and how? And of course, depending on your lens, informality is a good, a system, an infrastructure, a practice, or a service, or a series of systems, or a series of responses. And so we want to tease this out a little bit. In a world where breast milk sharing and cab sharing all fit in within the rubric of informality, we wonder, what does it actually mean to support and encourage informality and to incorporate it into the global formal economic systems of today? As our experts have pointed out in previous conversations and as they'll illustrate today, this new concept of the sharing economy, which has captured not only the national and international imagination, but also the very heavy wallets of the Silicon Valley investors, this concept of the sharing economy has existed for as long as people have shared space, as long as there have been communities. So we want to tease this concept out a little bit. To kick off the conversation, we're going to start with Emeka and then move across the panel, and our panelists will give us some examples from the regions in which they work of what informality is, what it looks like, and why it's emerged. Emeka?
Well, thanks for having me here. I would like to sort of have a different take on how we look at informality. I do a lot of work in Africa in a number of different areas, whether it's from an entrepreneurial standpoint, Maker Faire, and spurring innovation and technology. And one of the things that I have noticed is that when we look at what some might choose to describe as informal industrial structures, for example, clusters, across the continent, they tend to be the very kernels or areas of activity that everyone overlooks. They tend to be the areas that are actually much more productive than what some people consider to be the formal areas of the economy. And I would like to give two examples of what I mean by that. If you go to the metropolis of Lagos, which is the commercial center of Nigeria, some would say the largest megapolis in Africa. No one really knows what the population is. You know, it ranges from 8 million to 20. You have an industry that some of you might have heard of called Nollywood, which is a film industry that, based on the statistics you use, is one of the largest in the world in terms of the amount of movies that are being produced there. This is an example of an industry that had no input from government. It was completely emergent. It was something that happened despite formal political systems or despite economic intervention from those who we might consider the formal leaders of the economy. Yet, it's one of the key employers within the country, if not the region. What makes it informal? Well, the fact that almost every aspect of how it's put together or how it works goes against the grain of what we typically expect with a film industry. The movies are shot in 2 weeks. They're distributed on what you call video discs. They don't have any formal form of advertising, yet you have an industry that is larger than almost every other film industry in the world, apart from that of India and the United States. So that is just one snapshot of what some people might call informal, but is now being embraced by the formal economy. You now have the government of Nigeria looking at the import of this particular industry and saying to themselves, well, we actually had to readjust Nigeria's GDP because we were completely overlooking this industry. So Nigeria went from being the second largest economy in Africa to the largest, largely because of this hitherto informal industry. So that's one example. The second example I wanted to give is actually trans-regional. Whether you go to Nairobi in Kenya, Kumasi in Ghana, southeastern Nigeria, urban areas within Uganda, you find these industrial clusters, once again, informal industrial clusters, and I'd like to put that in quotes, that actually, some would argue, are the real engines of these economies. And you ask yourself, well, what's wrong here? How is it that the engines of the economy are not necessarily being recognized for what they are, while you have, quote unquote, the formal aspect of the economy looking for answers around youth unemployment, mm-hmm. industrial production, agricultural processing? So the point I'm looking to make here, the contention I'm putting forward is that particularly in the case of most parts of Africa, what some people might argue to be the informal economy is actually the economy. It's not informal in the sense that it's underground or it's illegal. It employs more people. It's actually more productive. It's actually much more efficient than, quote unquote, the formal economy. So I think when we're looking at some parts of the world, and once again, this is more so the case in the South, we may want to ask ourselves what we mean by the informal economy, what are we going to do to support it, and not necessarily strangle it by bringing it into contact with what some people define as the formal economy, and find ways to nourish it. And those methods might not necessarily be what are the methods that we consider traditional. There might be methods that we might have to sort of,
well done.
They might be methods that are adaptive, that are emergent, that will coalesce from what we learn by listening and looking, as opposed to what we impose from the outside. So I just wanted to give those broad examples about how I see the informal economy, and I think why we should actually redefine that term, or maybe look for a different way to restructure it. So,
excellent. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mark?
In a very different region, upstate New York is where I work. I think we suffer from an overabundance of formality and an overabundance of infrastructure, code, and institutions. And so we're sort of in a situation where we're trying to manage all of that infrastructure with a very changed population. So unlike a city like Detroit, Syracuse, the population has stabilized and is growing, but the growth is really coming from refugee and immigrant populations, which don't represent the same income as former populations that were coming into the city. So all of this infrastructure we're dealing with without the funds to actually maintain or augment it is creating what I think is an interesting moment of informality. And just two examples of that that I'd like to throw out is our water systems, our wastewater treatment systems in a growing city in the late 19th century up to World War II. We were able to build these big treatment plants, interstate highways. Now we have to actually maintain them. And in this era where we can't, the city and the county is really focusing on green infrastructure, on bioswales, on mitigating the stormwater through soft infrastructure. And so we're going back as a way of coping with a new economic condition of an infrastructure that one would consider informal, but actually is rational for the times. And as we see with climate-related disasters, which seem to be increasing, also a rational system in terms of resiliency. And so it's a very different situation, but I think the formal has to be rethought, and the informal has what can show us ways that in a shrinking or let's say legacy city, we can deal with some of these issues. In the other instance I would just mention is housing. We're in a situation, and this is the case also with de Blasio's new housing plan, mm-hmm. we have housing costs that exceed, the construction cost exceeds the incomes of the people that can afford the houses. So what we're seeing in the housing sector is also a kind of informality in that we have the infrastructure, but we don't have the ability to build the new infrastructure that might meet a changing population. So we have a lot of naturally occurring retirement communities, places that were built for families, but now are basically senior living facilities without the services of those senior living facilities. So how do we transform those housing units? Codes are just too slow, too sclerotic to make those changes. Our zoning codes don't change that quickly. We still have a problem with a not in my backyard mentality. What that means is people are changing informally those systems, whether it be doubling up, renting out garages, having extended families. So I think there are also ways in the housing sector, and this is upstate New York, but also I think New York City as well, for different reasons, that this informality is coming and our formal structures are really a little slow to catch up. So we have a competition for micro units, which is basically an acknowledgement that people were creating those on their own. So I think there are a number of different ways that we're becoming or acknowledging the informal. And that's basically a way of telling the policy and the other institutions to catch up with us.
Mm-hmm. So here I think we have some interesting example, an interesting example of how informality emerges because of paralysis, or informality emerges because of gaps, or it just already is there and we're failing to see it. And Jill, I think you can tell us a little bit about how both exist in Europe.
So it's, it's very interesting. Sorry. The volume on this is a little odd for me. It's very interesting to hear the conversation about this discussion of what informality is. Historically, traditionally, when we thought about informality, informality was often considered to be a moniker of backwardness. And the formal system was often perceived as a place of progress and development. And I think what we're beginning to see now is that dichotomy between the formal and the informal is really becoming increasingly meaningless. And I think we can see it when we have this kind of conversation. You know, we begin to see that when we talk about the lived experience in cities today, that there are all kinds of states of informality. Perhaps the traditional way we think about it is in terms of undeclared wage labor or in terms of uncontracted or precarious employment. But I think we begin to see that informal is also much broader. Informal is what we do for kin, what we do for neighbors, what acquaintances do for one another when the gaps begin to emerge and the systems don't work. So I've been doing research in West Europe. And I think one of the cases that I thought I would talk about is sort of the changing nature of informality in West Europe. So for example, in London at the moment, one of the big issues is the beds in shed epidemic. Increasingly because, like New York, such short, small vacancy rates in housing, at the same time you have austerity economies coming into play. So there's less money. People are have lower wages, but at the same time, rents have increased at a rate that the economy and the population simply can't afford. So there's this growing phenomena across, certainly in London, where people are converting the garden sheds in the back of their homes into informal housing, often illegal, often without water, often unsafe, often dangerous. Because rents in London are at in excess, it's more expensive than New York, in excess of $1,000 a month, increasingly, both legal and undocumented populations are finding it, finding housing precarious. So for example, last summer, 68 Romanian families were removed from vacant land by a local borough council. In another London borough in Slough, they're using drones to do thermal image sensoring to identify whether human beings are living in illegal housing. So in the process of making it incredibly impossible for people to afford to live, they're also criminalizing efforts to survive. And so you have a growing problem, which is often hidden, and it becomes very public when at Christmas last year, the Prime Minister stood with police force and removed families on Christmas Eve from Southall. Southall is a South Asian community, which probably is known as having probably the largest garden shed issue, and these populations were essentially put out onto the street. This kind of problem is happening across Europe. When you have open borders within Europe and the possibility of moving within the European borders, and you have very high unemployment rates, certainly in southern European countries, right? So in Spain, in Portugal, in Greece, right now it's estimated that the informal economy makes up about between 20 and 30% of the economies of these countries, and that informal economy is spurred not just by lack of jobs, but also employers. Employers are trying to evade having to pay the added taxes that austerity governments have levied on them. And so they are also increasingly taking on employees without contracts and in precarious situations. If you go across Europe, the situation is very different and it's changed with austerity. So the other case I'll mention is simply Ireland. In Ireland, informality really helped spur the Celtic Tiger. When Ireland's economy was booming, there was a huge construction industry, and at the same time, East European immigrants, particularly Polish immigrants, were the borders opened up. Ireland was one of the few countries when Poland was accepted to the EU that allowed Polish immigrants to come without any restrictions. And many Polish immigrants came and began work without contracts in the construction trade and in home maintenance and in the tourism trade, working in restaurants. Those populations have mobility, so now that the economy has transitioned, many of those populations have actually left, gone back home in search of other things, and the nature of the informal economy has changed. Now the domestic population is in a precarious position because there are fewer jobs and the domestic population is in trouble, and the informal economy has actually shifted to goods and services. Ireland now has a growing challenge with illegal pharmaceuticals, illegal cigarettes, alcohol, the things, the goods and services that people domestically can no longer afford to purchase are now moving in and out of the country through these informal channels. So when we were talking about this conversation about informality, we realized that basically we could talk. There's so many different nuances to it. But there's definitely been a transition and a shift. There's more precariousness that populations are facing, and at the same time, governments are becoming much more restrictive, much more focused on criminalizing those inequalities. So the last point I'll make is that, you know, this is actually quite different than what has happened historically with informality in many European countries. Housing is a great example, squatting. There have been a squatters movement in London since the 1960s. But in the earlier years, basically squatters would occupy property that was vacant and abandoned and was not being used. Councils accepted that, allowed that squatting to go on. And that led actually to a movement that spurred the government in the 70s to create squatters' rights so that people couldn't just summarily be removed from property without going to the courts and without there being some kind of legal process for it. Yeah. This past year, all of that has changed. And now you can be criminally prosecuted for squatting on vacant lands. And so now squatters can be imprisoned for up to 5 years. They can be charged lots and lots of fees. And so the whole nature of informality is now criminalized. The problem with all of this is if they criminalize the informality too much, then it will feed over into protests on the streets. So right now, governments are in quite a tricky situation. Letting informality happen allows them to avoid having to deal with some of the gaps in services that governments are unable to provide right now. But if they continue the criminalization process, it will, I would anticipate it's going to result in some real social protest problems in the future. I mean, we see it in Greece. Right, but that what you saw in Greece is unique in West Europe. I would suspect that would be a bigger problem.
Yeah. Well, I think you've actually responded really well to the range of different issues that we've talked about. So in the past, traditionally, informality, it's been referred to in a number of different ways. We have some of our newer scholars, like Bob Neuwirth, has come up with really cool little riffy terms like System D. You know, we have informality has always been referred to in a number of different ways. But in the past, it's also been known as the shadow economy, the gray economy. And I think what we've seen here is this recurring thread that all of our speakers have talked about is this idea of seeing and not seeing. Seeing what is already there, not seeing, you know, what we don't want to see. But then we've also heard that, you know, sometimes in an attempt to kind of incorporate informal economic activity, we have driven people further underground. This has happened throughout the world. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how, if you all can just sort of respond a little bit to this idea about how in the past we have attempted to incorporate informal economic activity into systems. How is this possible in a place like Emeka has talked about, where the formal economy is a fraction as productive as the informal economic activity, where the informal economic activity in Kenya, for example, created 86% of new jobs, I believe was the statistic, in the last year. How do we deal with that where perhaps the agents of incorporation should not be governments? Mm-hmm. So maybe you can respond to this a little bit.
Sure. I think one of the bigger challenges is when you look at institutions within some of these countries, people generally talk about, well, you need strong institutions, whether it's a judiciary, educational systems, and so forth. But if the institutions themselves are weak, and you have actually more adaptive institutions, such as that are quote-unquote informal, that are stronger, the question becomes, I think, how do we make those more informal entities precursors of what the institutions could be? Mm-hmm. So the question isn't, you know, going to a government minister in Accra and saying, well, how do we improve our agricultural distribution system? It's actually that minister taking a step down and listening to those who have already, by their resourcefulness and their need to fill gaps, to use a term used earlier, solve that problem. They're continuously solving problems. So I think it will take a lot of humility on the part of quote-unquote formal institutions in most parts of the world to actually realize that they're not getting it right. And this is obviously very different to what is happening in Europe or in the United States. But where you have very weak institutions, right. I honestly feel that we're dealing with the wrong set of people. When I see an American, I won't call any names, philanthropist visit Nigeria or any of these African countries, and they sit down with the minister to talk about any number of problems, it's so obvious to many people that they're talking to the wrong people.
Right. Well, I think, I mean, you make a very interesting point about just humility. I mean, power structures are powerful because people don't want to be humble, right? But I want to actually, before we go back to you, Mark, I wanted to link you back to Jill. You had mentioned that in the austerity era, European institutions are weakening in their ability to extend, exercise, and execute their regulatory regimes that they're imposing on themselves. I wonder if you can maybe respond a little bit.
Yeah, and I mean, I think there's an interesting conversation that's happening, but it's not spoken about. And I think that if you look at what's going on, there's definitely a push these days. You know, having strong institutions is potentially just as bad as having weak institutions if they're sclerotic, if they're really rigid and unable to bend. And I mean, that's certainly been a problem, you know, with cities. You know, in Europe, you've got growing cities, you've got shrinking cities. Mm-hmm. And shrinking cities are really taking, I think, this problem, this challenge on in a more creative way. Governments are also, I think, what you're starting to see happen is, which is something that we in the U.S. are much more familiar with, is that there's an increasing emphasis on the importance of community voice. Mm-hmm. In the U.S., we have a tradition of grassroots democracy. I mean, it doesn't always work, but we have that tradition here. Whereas in West Europe, where you have a much greater tradition coming out of World War II of welfare states that were top-down controlled, and you have much stronger states, those aren't working. So there's definitely a push, if you look across the European Union, for this idea of really injecting community voice into things. Mm-hmm. And there was an interesting case in a German city in Westphalia, which has been shrinking. Smaller cities tend to be the shrinking cities in West Europe. There are a lot of shrinking cities in Europe. And so you have aging populations, shrinking populations, infrastructure that's lying fallow in the same sense. And what they've been doing there is really trying to create this idea of the emergent city, to use the language of the title of this conference, the idea that you have to start to look at cities as becoming. And you have to look at institutions in a much more flexible way, rethinking sort of what connects us between cities. There was an article by Dan Hill who talked about this German case of bottom-up planning. And the case, basically, the long and the short of the story is that the city was in trouble. It's on the periphery of one of the major industrial areas. Industry changes, and the metal industry particularly was drying up. So people started leaving the town. And they're left then with losing. The nursery schools are closing, secondary schools are closing, there's inadequate resources to take care of things. So they began a revisioning of the city. They brought residents together, a new mayor came in, that helped.
That helps.
And the mayor sat down and brought residents out to sit down to talk about how we reimagine the city. Not iconic mega projects that are supposed to lure sort of the big ticket items in, not building convention centers. And what they ended up coming up with was the fact that this was a waterfront community on the river. They had lost access to the waterfront. The quality of life had declined. So the community all agreed that what they needed to do for the people who were staying was create a quality of life that would enable them to take care of their own systems. And that's exactly what they've started to do. So the city paid for the resources, the physical resources that the city needed, the concrete, metal, stone, to get the roads a little bit cleaner and to get the waterfront looking prettier. And they closed down the city for a series of weekends throughout the summer and asked the residents to come out and do the work themselves. And so you had a synergy that emerged in a kind of relationship and social capital and a recognition that government couldn't do it all. And so it brought partners in from unlikely places, and that kind of strategy is happening more and more.
Now, Mark, I think you have some responses to that as well, right? I saw you shaking your head when we were talking earlier about how in the West or in the global North our institutions aren't weak. So,
well, I was just thinking about, I mean, speaking of talking to the wrong people and not being humble, I mean, in this state, incarceration was an economic development strategy, still is upstate, right? You all else fails, like build prisons and send people from New York City up there, strengthen the drug laws, and that brings income to upstate towns. I mean, you know, even though it sounds ridiculous, And we're finally starting to deal with that issue. You know, I think we're paying for empty prisons for the next 3 years, you know, to sort of like wean those towns off of that economic development strategy. So I think, unfortunately, that kind of thinking can be universal sometimes. Like, we, whatever the strategy is, let's, you know, come up with a method. I'd much prefer an informal strategy to that, and the Cuomo administration and finally the feds are starting to acknowledge that. So,
do you know what's happening to those towns with the empty prisons? Do you know what they're planning to do?
I can tell you what I think of those towns that would want to grow that way, but I'll paint the happy picture, which is that we. In Syracuse, have gotten a grant from the state and the feds to look at alternatives to incarceration. So steering people towards a restorative justice and peacemaking process with the help of parole, prisons, prosecutors, so that they don't even enter that system, that they have a community process that comes together with their neighbors, aggrieved perpetrators, and try to come up with a solution. And frankly, that's an economic development strategy because you're not ruining somebody's life. So I think that was also an acknowledgement of a more informal strategy, and they're looking at some Native American strategies where we abut the Onondaga Nation, and they have a kind of history of peacemaking and looking at ways that might solve some of these problems that we had over the last 40 years used incarceration for. So I hope that's a start.
That's interesting. I know Jill wanted to respond.
I was just going to say, and one of my students did a project on a group that's emerged in New York called Milk Not Jails, which is an advocacy group going and working with upstate communities to try and advocate for creating a smaller footprint for our dairy industry so that smaller farms can be built and sort of create connections with the food circuit in New York, so there's some creative stuff happening.
Very interesting. I have one last question for the panel, and then I want to open it up to the floor. We've talked a lot around this issue of, you know, informality and where it's happening and why, and I think the big linchpin always is migration, right? People are moving at higher rates and to new locations at unprecedented rates. And that's causing all kinds of, this is your big issue, inclusion, all kinds of issues about who it has a right to belong in, not just in the legal system, but in the economies. So I wonder if we can talk a little bit about, you know, why informality happens amid so much migration, and why that kind of feeds into these criminalization narratives, right, that you spoke about, how that's affecting local populations as well. And then I think finally, if we can talk a little bit about the fact that these kind of systems of predation where, you know, immigrant communities tend to prey on their own, right, the newer arrivals, and these systems of exploitation. I've heard a lot of people in New York City, for example, call for greater regulation on immigrant-run small businesses, these predatory businesses that charge all kinds of crazy fees to new arrivals and promise the moon to undocumented people. I don't believe personally that regulation is really the answer, but I wonder if we can talk a little bit about that, you know, just migration in the world and how to respond to it. Another small topic.
Give it to me, I can talk for the next 3 hours on that topic.
Yeah, please.
Look, I mean, the more mobility that populations have, the easier it is for predatory behaviors to emerge. It becomes possible for an employer to say, well, I'm not going to hire you, but I'll hire you at a lower rate. You know, so it creates new labor markets, and those new labor markets kind of mushroom out. This idea of the exploited labor and preying on one's own is also a problem. I did some interviews with police in South London, Southwest London, and they talked about how in one community, it was a South Asian community, that the affluent immigrants were bringing lower caste immigrants from home countries over, and putting them in incredibly difficult and dangerous situations. But they were also hiding and protecting this. So the police had a very difficult time identifying where the problem was, because these populations, these were illegal. And refugee populations are the bottom of the barrel. Certainly in West Europe, refugee populations, if you, while you're in refugee status, you're put in an isolated location. In Ireland, they call them reception centers.
Mm-hmm. You're not getting cookies. You're
not getting cookies there. And while you're in that holding pattern, the amount of resources and revenues that you're given are minuscule. And so there is no out, right? You either stay where you are and your refugee claim gets consideration from the government, or you leave your really horrible refugee status and you get exploited by other populations. So you have, you know, a whole stream of things happening, and it's very complex. It's, you know, in planning they talk about wicked problems. Wicked problems are incredibly complex because they, this isn't, you know, with integration, it involves housing, it involves immigration, it involves language, it involves human rights and employment, and all of those are treated by separate branches of government. So it's very easy for it to kind of, populations to fall through the cracks, and for those who are perpetrating the negative condition, they can escape blamelessly, while those who are in the vulnerable position are potentially thrown back.
Yeah. So on the flip side, we talk about how growth is in upstate growing out of these refugee and immigrant populations, but we also have heard calls for using immigration policies, regional immigration policies, to repopulate shrinking cities in the U.S. Yeah. I wonder if you have some thoughts on that.
That's the only way they're going to grow, I think. And I think Toronto is one of the best examples, same climate, and an embrace of immigrants, and tremendous growth. Mm-hmm. So I think if you have a strategy for taking in those refugee or immigrant populations and supporting them, then in those cities that aren't having natural growth but need in-migration for growth, you have tremendous opportunity. Mm. And, you know, I think there's a kind of feedback that it can be also the source of innovation in many ways.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's also just the age difference in new residents and existing residents is so large. It's, you know, you want to have schools, you want to keep schools open, mm-hmm. You want to have that healthy population that stays mm-hmm. And doesn't leave. And so I think you have to figure out support mechanisms, but also acknowledge that people in these cities with lower resources are also struggling, and a way to balance that, which I definitely don't have an answer for.
And of course, one of the first points that you made, Emeka, was that no one really knows how big Lagos is. Part of that is because of these populations that are difficult to count, that are moving, you know, in transmigrant pathways and just in and out of the city, and, you know, who knows who is where, and refugees and new people, all of that, internal migrants and all of that. I wonder if you have some thoughts about, you've been very kind of vocal advocate for, you know, these makers and tinkerers and people who are on the fringe and uncounted as the real vehicles of economic growth and power, but there are vulnerabilities there. I wonder if you could speak to that.
Oh, yes, there are a ton of vulnerabilities. The fact that they are on the margins and they don't have the attributes that are typically associated with formality places them in this very vulnerable place. And I think it's important to find a way to give individuals or groups of individuals like this agency. And one of the ways you seek to do that, which is partially what we've tried to do with things like Make a Fair, is validate what they're doing. Mm-hmm. So, for example, when we've gone to had events in places like Accra, in Cairo, wherever we've gone, one of the typical things we find is that the very residents of those cities that are quote unquote more elite are completely unaware of what innovators within their own city are doing, and it's somewhat ironic that you are in Lagos and the people who put Make a Fair together come from all over. I live here in New York, and you have someone who's from Lagos who doesn't really know what an innovator 2 miles away is doing, and you ask yourself, why do you have this disconnect? How do you have societies assess in a very sort of analytical way the assets that they have around them? And somewhat to jump across an ocean, you know, I live in Brooklyn, and I've noticed how you have immigrant communities being sort of the forefront of what you could call rejuvenation of certain communities that seem as if at some point they were on the edge. And I wonder whether people realize the role they play, because whenever we hear about gentrification, people think it's outsiders coming from the Midwest and so on. But sometimes it's actually these immigrants who are at the tip of the spear, who are populating and seeding these communities and creating these nucleuses of industry that we typically overlook. Just go to Fulton Street in Brooklyn, for example, and Flatbush and all these other places. And I think they're under-acknowledged for the value they bring and the risks they take. Well, maybe risk is the wrong term, but there is value there once again that I think we do not take on board.
Right. In terms of under-acknowledged, you'll be happy to know that I think the America Society just came out with a report basically saying that immigrants were the reason why New York didn't die in the 70s. It's an interesting report. All right, let's open it up to the floor. We have a lot of great thinkers here, you, sir, and then you in the back. I believe we have microphones going around. I would just want to ask you, when you get the mic, please stand, introduce yourself, and if you can keep yourself to a question and not a comment. Thank you.
To the gentleman from Nigeria, I've been here 45 years from Egypt, okay? So I wonder what a rich country like Nigeria, where all that money goes. Lagos, they're 80% people on generators to generate their electricity. Is that correct? In Financial Times, I read that.
Might be worse, but.
Yes, worse. And for example, I never experienced that in Egypt. Now there is a shortages, right? But that's for a different reason. But where all the money in Nigeria goes? There is no revolution. Egypt has to go to 2 revolutions in less than 3 years. 2 presidents in jail. And finally, all the people work in the media, I watch them now, they get the minister and they interrogate him live. What are you owing the solution for these people? And he has to respond. It's complete change in 3 years. No minister cannot answer the interviewer on TV. Mm-hmm. This place, when they go undocument, and you watch what's going to happen in the next 8 years in Egypt. Mm.
Do you have a
why there is no revolution in Nigeria?
Thank you.
Well, you know, that's a topic for an entire event. But I think a couple of days ago, I tried to synthesize for some friends of mine a problem that is not just specific to Nigeria, but specific to many countries in sub-Saharan Africa. Mm. And for me, societies that are unable to develop what I like to call autocatalytic, self-sustaining, problem-solving abilities without external intervention are doomed to be in that state till the point where they're able to do so. What does that mean? If you are not able to identify, as I mentioned earlier, problem-solving kernels within your society and build them up, either have them come together naturally or organically grow them, you're always going to run into this situation where it's going to be one problem or the other problem. It could be health today, it could be starvation the next day. So not to generalize, and I'm not an expert on North Africa. You know, I was in Cairo the year of the revolution in 2011. Yeah. I think that at some level, and this is completely anecdotal, that you have kernels of problem-solving I would like to say mechanics in Egypt and in the rest of the Arab world that at some point was able to reach a threshold and demand for change. What you have in most of Africa is people looking for, sub-Saharan Africa, is people looking for solutions to be solved by others. Mm. And this is something I and others have been harping on for the past 10 years. And those problem solvers are there, but you have to empower them. And you have to bring them together, and you have to build these communities of problem solvers. And when you have problem solvers across the board, you can solve any solution that, any problem that you're confronted with. Mm-hmm. And that's why we do what we do. You know, I'm not really interested in the person who has the biggest, the most pedigree, or the most degrees, or the most money. I'm always looking for who are the problem solvers in every society, mm-hmm. and how do you empower them? And I think that's the only way you can, over time, evolve solutions. I don't know if that answers your question, but that is.
I think we had a gentleman in the back. A gentleman in the back, and then this lady in the front, you three, and then you four.
Good evening. My name is Monil. I'm an economics student here at Hunter. This is a question general to the panel overall, but Mr. Okafor, you mentioned that, you know, formalizing sectors would bring people more benefits, but at the same time, wouldn't that make cities more attractive to people perhaps from rural regions? And wouldn't that put a strain on resources of a city? For example, it's, you know, hospitals or subway system, for example. But then on the flip side, Ms. Gross, you mentioned that, you know, opening borders would allowed Polish immigrants to go back to Poland from Ireland. So on the flip side, you know, there's an economic principle, open borders, you know, move resources more easily from place to place. So that would help, you know, people. So, you know, what do you think the answer to that would be? Would you want, right. you know, open borders?
Thank you. Why don't we take a couple of questions and then have the panelists respond? You were next. Yes, ma'am, in the red sweater. And then.
Hi, I'm Suzanne Sherbeck. I'm a writer in New York, and I wondered what role informality has played in the rise of Islamic extremists, particularly in Nigeria.
And then I think we had.
I'm only focusing on Nigeria because it's in the news, but the general issue of the rise of Islamic extremism in Africa.
And then I think we'll take you, and then we'll have the panelists respond.
Thank you, a very interesting discussion. I'm interested in the concept of informality and the growing centers in China, Shanghai, Hubei, etc., and the fact that it is the informal society within those cities that have actually probably very instrumental in creating some of the problems that they're having right now, such as certainly overpopulation and pollution. And the only way that is being taken care of right now, it seems, that is struggling, is with a government coming down, so the formal has to put stirrups on the informal. So I'm just wondering, A, are we learning from that, and B, how, what lessons can we learn from that? Yeah. Mm.
So three very interesting questions. One, just to recap, one is, you know, if we are looking to advocate for more open borders, I think the solution to the problem, I think it was a sort of a chicken and the egg sort of question. When you have all of these resources, this innovation and energy happening in cities, people move into cities, that causes resource strain. How do we respond? Open border seems to be the way of the future, but how do we respond? After that, we had the question of how is informality contributing to the rise of Islamism in Africa? And then we had the question of informality in China seems to be causing some of the great problems that we're looking at, the resource strains. If we don't have formal strong governments, then how do you respond to those?
I could.
In any order.
I could answer, well, I can't answer your question, but an interesting thing happened. Nanjing University came to Syracuse on a kind of a trip with engineers, architects, other people, and they were talking about this tremendous growth and how great it was to breathe clean air. I mean, it's fascinating when you talk to people that come from Beijing and Shanghai and other cities. The air is a a huge issue. And, you know, a lot of people in upstate New York long for the days of the dirty air. And I said, you know, we were the Shenzhen of 1890. So, you know, be careful, because now we're dealing, right, because they do deal with their issues through infrastructure, through, you know, massive housing blocks, through road construction, through, I think it, the statistic is like a coal.
35 million coal.
Yeah. And a new coal-fired power plant every couple of months is built. And I think they're going to have to deal with much faster than cities in the U.S. and Europe the consequence of maintaining or you know, just keeping up that infrastructure. So I think there has to. I think it's a good time to look at some more sustainable structures.
Please.
Also, I mean, in the China case, the state is responsible for creating the informality in the first place. You know, up until the economy opened in the late 1980s, they had the Hukuo and the Danwei system. So you had rural communities in China that were industrial communities. And if you lived in those rural areas, with that rural status came social housing, came health insurance, came care. Because China is pursuing growth on such a massive scale, they've begun deregulating some of this. And so for those populations who are living in these Danwei homes in the rural areas, they now have nowhere to go. Mm-hmm. And so they come to the city as the only place where there is an economy to sustain them. And so it becomes, again, a survival strategy. There's no, and right now there's a huge competition going on, and this sort of, I was going to mention this earlier. I mean, we also, I think, have a challenge here, because the dominant way of thinking about cities is that cities should always grow. Growth is the dominant paradigm, and that's, and I think what we're seeing right now is that that's a big problem. And so you have, certainly in Europe, cities are starting to kind of rethink what the size of cities should be. And as long as China pursues this massive growth without having planning, right? And, you know, that's another challenge, right? There's a real difficulty in engaging communities in cross-border thinking, regional strategies, because the kinds of problems that you're talking about, especially these environmental problems, are happening at the gaps. They're happening in the places where government isn't. Mm-hmm. And so you have huge environmental problems happening, and where government is as well, yeah. Because they're incentivizing. They're incentivizing a certain type of growth at the expense of the environment.
Yeah. Yeah. Which I think also responds to your question about the resource strain.
I'll speak to the question about on Islamic extremism. I see Islamic extremism in Nigeria or anywhere else within Africa, even in parts of South Asia, as a symptom of policies that haven't worked, when policies that are not allowing the young to be absorbed. Mm-hmm. And when you have a preponderance of young men who, well, they're mostly men, who have a sense of hopelessness, they will fall prey to any form of any range of activities. It could be Islamic extremism, it could be other forms of attraction that are somewhat less productive. What you see in Nigeria is really the result of some would say 40, 50 years of corruption. The fact that tremendous amounts of wealth have been created and literally wasted, stolen, and so forth. And what you now have in Nigeria today is a situation where the government allocates a huge amount of money to security, but you have to ask yourself, well, where is that money going?
Yeah.
And that's the uncomfortable question. And the thing is, if you overlook corruption, if you overlook leaders who will visit the White House and wine and dine with our leaders here in Europe and not question them and put them in the hot seat, you begin to pay the price in other ways. Mm-hmm. And what you see in Nigeria is just a symptom of that. It's not because they're any more interested in being extreme than anybody else. It's just that you reach this critical mass where the problem persists, it's swept under the carpet, the number of young people increase, they're brutalized, and the level of fatalism increases, and that's what you have today. It's just that simple. Mm-hmm. But if you speak to most people, they'll say, well, they're just fanatics. Well, they were fanatics for a reason. And no one is justifying what they're doing, but the crux of the matter is that these governments and the government in Nigeria with all its resources hasn't found a way, even though it's staring them in the face, to put its citizens to productive use. And till they're able to do so or recognize where it's happening on its own, we'll be faced with this problem of extremism or anything that is similar. I don't know if that answers the question. But it's a symptom. It's not something that is fundamental.
And the second part of that question was, you know, whether informality, like how that relates to it. So I think that goes to your question of how to nourish the informal spaces in such a way that you incorporate these sort of disengaged, and which that have, I mean, we have disenfranchised youth in every city.
Yeah, I was going to say that what you described certainly throughout northern England is exactly the same phenomena. Incredibly high youth unemployment, and it becomes really kind of a seeding ground for where the opportunities are.
I think we had several. I missed somebody was over here. It was you, gentlemen, and then you, and then you. I'm sorry. I'm happy to see so many hands in there. You all keep holding me to it.
Hi. I'm Albert Golson. I write on urban planning and security issues. You mentioned just briefly about strong institutions, weak institutions, strong institutions, and I believe it comes down to enforceability. You can have strong institutions, but weak enforcement, which is deliberately done as far as weak enforcement. You can have weak institutions, but strong enforcement. So there is a big gray area there. My key critical question, you're talking about government policies and grassroots, et cetera, but I believe there's a stronger thread in all of these areas. Basically, they're big business. To what extent do big business, real estate developers, large corporations have an influence on government policy with respect to the informal economy?
Mm-hmm. Interesting. You, sir? And then this woman?
Mike McDonald from Global Resilience Systems Initiative. I'm very interested in the difference between informality and robust civil society, mm-hmm. and the possibility that we're actually seeing an emerging complex adaptive system that's something quite different than perhaps what's being talked about so far. And if you look at the Sandy, Superstorm Sandy, for example, the formal systems collapsed. They didn't work in the Rockaways. And if you look at the Red Cross, which was supposed to be, you know, by mandated by Congress to be the major responder, they just didn't work. And you had 12,000 volunteers, most of them out from outside of New York City. But you had an opposition movement called Occupy Wall Street, which then morphed into Occupy Sandy. They had over 80,000 volunteers. Now, social media is playing a huge part in this. And I'd like to suggest that there's actually something much more organized in what you're calling informality, and that it actually has huge power and is converging into something quite new and unpredictable.
Hi, I'm Anna Garcia. I'm with the New York Academy of Medicine. I wanted to ask about the caregiving sector. Caregiving so often happens in an informal way, and I was wondering if the speakers had any examples or insight into ways that that sector has sort of increased in quality and avoided exploitation without increasing costs for the cities where it's sort of being examined.
Fantastic. So strong, weak institutions. Strong and weak institutions versus enforcement and the influence of big business on informality. Then we have informality and the rise of a robust civil society. Comment on what we see in this rising metropolitan informality that's converging. And then caregiving sector.
Robust civil society. I'm going to go there. I agree. I think there's actually something bigger going on, and I actually think the language that we're using, formal-informal, is is a mistake. We haven't really figured out a new language to talk about something that's very interesting. I mean, once we started talking amongst ourselves about the sharing economy and these kinds of, you know, the way in which technology is being used, at the same time, it's being used by communities that are on the more affluent side. You have to have access to the technology to work, but there's some really, I mean, in London, you've got ground share where people who have lands are matching up with people who have seeds and they want to do urban farming. There's Freegal, there's Freecycle. Instead of throwing things out, just put it up on the board and we can recycle it. So there's much more of this kind of barter and trade, and there's much more connectivity electronically, but I don't believe that it's yet encompassing some of the more marginalized populations. They may be marginalized economically at the lowest end of the economy, or new immigrants who may lack the linguistic skills or the connections and ties to communities. So I agree there's something interesting going on. I agree that the academic world hasn't really quite figured out the language to really understand what's happening. There's definitely a push to get civil society more mm-hmm. engaged. But I still think there are divisions that system doesn't, that it's a robust civil society for some of civil society.
Mm-hmm.
On the sort of big corporation thing, I think I've always had a dilemma with affordable housing, even though it's kind of my industry, in that, you know, in this city, basically, for every affordable unit, you need three market rate units, right? If you're saying that 20% of a building should be affordable, you're saying 80% should be unaffordable, right? I mean,
yeah.
or affordable yeah. to a different population.
Yeah, pretty much.
And so it seems like a losing game. Right, if you want to create 200,000 units, well, divide that by 30%, and that's how many market rate units you're going to get. So that's one strategy that I think benefits a lot of people that have power and have lobbying strength. But we have other strategies. In Portland, they legalized backyard garages being converted to granny flats or accessory dwelling units, but they get inspected.
Mm-hmm.
That's a much cheaper solution, a much different city, but also just a very different philosophy about how you create affordable units. But I think if you're in a situation where every affordable unit means, you know, X times market rate units, then you are setting yourself up for a situation where you're going to have a kind of unequal dichotomy. I mean, it's just never going to catch up. But I think a lot of people benefit from that structure. And that's a structure that you can finance and leverage. And if you need a lot of units, then, you know, maybe that's the way you do it. But I think we have other examples of how you can do that, maybe in lower density cities, but mm-hmm. ways in which you can push a little more informality into the system and have a more grassroots way rather than a kind of industry-driven way of doing it.
Wow, really interesting, yeah. Does anybody have any thoughts on the caregiving question, about caregiving?
I have thoughts on the peer-to-peer distributed okay. Forms of looking at problems. I think that when I look at the work of a number of organizations that I'm related to, such as Maker Faire Africa, the people in the Maker Movement, Hacker Spaces, one of the things that we think we're doing is finding alternative ways to build institutions around the existing institutions that are weak. Mm-hmm. So in other words, you have research universities who are plodding away doing what they do mm-hmm. across Africa, but they're not getting anywhere fast, at least most of them. So when you have these spaces, for example, where you can have the distributed knowledge, you have the peer-to-peer technologies, you have a very sort of non-hierarchical way of approaching problem solving, you find that you're able to accelerate knowledge transfer, you're able to accelerate activities in a way that up until now seemed quite forbidding. Mm-hmm. A case in point is if you looked at policies that built what they call telecenters, you know, these were these massive white elephants where a lot of money was spent in quote-unquote bridging the digital divide top-down, they didn't really achieve that much. But if you look at more sort of emergent hubs that were built in a very non-hierarchical way, where there weren't these barriers to entry, they didn't predetermine who could get involved. In some way, some could argue, they have led to a proliferation of knowledge transfer and business generation and incubation, and even the growth of civic society that was unanticipated. So mm-hmm. there's something about what some people call peer-to-peer methodologies that I think speaks to the informal way of doing things that the formal world is now catching up to, mm-hmm. even in this country. And it will be interesting to see how you could apply that to any range of topics, including perhaps caregiving, which I would think could be part of that as well.
Well, thank you all very much. I think we're going to conclude our conversation. I know there were some other questions that went unanswered. I want to invite all of you to give our wonderful panelists a round of applause. And our wonderful hosts at Roosevelt House, thank you all so much. We will keep this conversation going for the next many years, I imagine. So please feel free to follow all of our panelists on Twitter and to follow the Roosevelt House as well, and to follow all of each other. We'll just follow each other in a feedback loop endlessly. And please do stay in touch, and we will look forward to our next one. Thank you very much.